This is a follow-up to the recent video on uniform duals. In it, I stated that these 11 hemipolyhedra, which have faces passing through the centre, do not have duals. However, there are ways around this. This video will discuss two of them. Firstly, a quick reminder of how a dual is constructed using the cube octahedron. To find the dual face of a vertex, create a sphere touching the edges. Mark the points on the edges around the vertex where the sphere touches the edges, and draw tangents at these points perpendicular to the edges. These are the dual face edges, so the vertices are the intersections of these tangents. Repeat for all vertices, and you have the dual, in this case the rhombic dodecahedron. However, with a hemipolyhedron, such as this tetrahemihexahedron, this doesn't work. We can draw the tangents, but tangents through points 1 and 2 are parallel, so they don't intersect and we can't find a dual vertex. The tangents through points 3 and 4 are also parallel. So strictly speaking, there is no dual. However, we can get some sort of dual by moving the sphere away from the centre, up and right for example. The tangents shift accordingly, and now they do intersect. We have a dual face, which is a bow-tie shape, a crossed quadrilateral. My first way of approximating the dual, then, is to locate the sphere near to the centre, but not actually on it. To do this, I'll switch to a different view, so you can see the entire dual at once. Here, the hemipolyhedron is on the left, with the sphere at its centre, so there is no dual. I've marked the centre of the sphere with a white dot. Move the sphere anywhere else, and we do get a dual shape. As we move the sphere around, the dual changes too. These dual shapes are all topologically the same, but as you can see, they can be highly distorted. If I move the sphere very near to a face, the dual vertex grows rapidly. Moving it onto the face causes an error, but moving it past to the other side, the dual vertex reappears the other side. Moving back again, the dual disappears, then reappears flipped back again. Now, we'll move the sphere as close as we can towards the centre. We're approaching all three central faces, so all vertices are growing. If we stop just before reaching the centre, we have the closest you can get to a dual. This is our first candidate for the dual of the tetrahemihexahedron, which I'll call the nearly dual. It's dominated by three square pyramids extending a long way in perpendicular directions. It has six faces, but they have different shapes. The red faces are crossed bowtie shapes, but the yellow faces are dart-shaped. Uniform duals should be isohedral with similar faces, so this is not ideal. More crucially though, the dual should have the same symmetry as the original, and that is clearly not the case here. For the second candidate dual, we'll go back to the figure with the parallel lines which don't intersect. Or maybe they do intersect. If you've ever looked down a long, straight railway track, although you know the rails are parallel, they do appear to intersect at a point in the distance. Turn round and look the other way, and they also appear to intersect at another point in the opposite direction. We can treat this perspective effect as real, and say that parallel lines do intersect at infinity in both directions. So the horizontal lines intersect at infinity off to the left and right, the vertical lines intersect at infinity off the top and bottom, and the dual face becomes a cross shape like this. Put the six faces together and you get this figure. Magnus Wenninger, author of three classic books about polyhedron modelling, suggested this technique, so I'll call this Wenninger's dual. The arms should really be infinitely long, but are truncated for practical reasons. This figure has become quite well known, and many people regard it as the correct dual. But if you look a bit closer, there are several problems. The vertices of the tetrahemihexahedron border four faces, so the dual faces should have four sides, but they actually have eight. We'd expect seven vertices, as the tetrahemihexahedron has seven faces, but there are six infinite vertices, and 8 near the centre, making 14. and the cross shape has octahedral symmetry, but the tetrahemihexahedron has only tetrahedral symmetry. What's happened is that having parallel lines intersecting twice creates as many problems as having them not intersect at all. We've ended up with twice the vertices, twice the edges, and twice the symmetry we expected. The only way to get this to work properly is to treat the two intersections of parallel lines as the same point. This is a bizarre notion, but it's the only way out. We're saying this point and this point are the same point. East is west. If you can accept this, the face sides and vertices are as follows. Vertex 1 is here at the far left, which is the same as here at the far right. Vertex 2 is here. Vertex 3 is at the top, which is the same as the bottom. And vertex 4 is here. The sides all proceed in two directions at once. Side 1, side 2, side 3, side 4. This way, we have the expected number of vertices and faces and the expected symmetry. So Wenninger's dual is much stranger than it looks. We've stumbled into an alternative type of geometry called projective geometry. It's a well-explored branch of mathematics, but it's not the real world. Here are the two candidate duals side by side for comparison. Duals for the other 10 hemipolyhedra can be found in the same ways. The dual of the octahemioctahedron is the octahemioctachron. It has four hexagonal spikes in the Neely dual, or four hexagonal prisms in the Wenninger dual. This illustrates another problem with the Neely dual. The spikes always end up different lengths, further reducing its symmetry. The dual of the cubohemioctahedron is the hexahemioctachron. This is visually the same as the previous one, because the two have the same faces through the centre. The dual of the small icosihemidodecahedron has six octagonal spikes or prisms, and has the same appearance as the next figure, the dual of the small dodecahemidodecahedron. The dual of the small dodecahemicosahedron has 10 spikes or prisms. Again, the next figure, the dual great dodecahemicosahedron, is visually the same. The dual of the great dodecahemidodecahedron has 6 decagramic spikes or prisms, and looks the same as the dual of the great icosihemidodecahedron. The dual of Miller's monster, the great dirhombicosidodecahedron, has no less than 60 square spikes or prisms that occur in coincident pairs rotated with respect to each other, so they look octagramic. And finally, Skilling's figure, the great disnub dirhombidodecahedron. Its dual is visually identical to the great dirhombicosidodecahedron dual. So the big question is, do you think these are good representations of duals of hemipolyhedra? Or is it better to simply say such duals don't exist? Please leave a comment below. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next video.